So this is basically a session for those who couldn't make it the other day. The Zoom just allows for 100 participants, so we couldn't accommodate everyone the first time. So I thought it'd be good to do it again, because I enjoyed doing it a lot on the first time, because it was it was like reliving my last 4 years in Ladakh, because as you know, all of us are at homes in quarantine. So it was a nice way to go back there, at least in our heads. So before we get into Ladakh, the Trans-Himalaya, the wildlife, the snow leopards, I just want to tell you a bit about myself. I'm basically a naturalist guy. I started my association with hardcore wildlife in Central India, where I worked in Satpura Tiger Reserve, where we did a lot of fun things over there. That was my initial few years in the wildlife scene. And it was like living the dream. You know, it was the first time in my life I was living next to wildlife in my backyard. I was walking in the park, I was canoeing, I was seeing leopards, tigers, sloth bears. It was a beautiful, beautiful time at the start. And I quickly got hooked on to forests, as we all know it, you know, the trees, the streams, the biodiversity, everything. It was not just the big mammals that ticked it off for me. It was everything. It was almost, you can say, including spiders, butterflies, dragonflies, frogs, snakes, the trees, the flowers. It was all quite fascinating for me. So about 5 years ago, I shifted to Kanha from Satpura, where I got a chance to work up close with these beautiful animals, the Bengal tiger. You have to realize in Satpura, we at that point didn't see many tigers. It was more about the biodiversity as such, which is something I enjoyed. But having said that, I did love the time I spent in the Sal forest in the meadows of Kanha, tracking tigers. And it was an interesting two seasons of my life. But I don't know what happened after that. I got an opportunity to basically shift from the green part of India to the red dot on top, which is what is Ladakh. And it sounded great at the start, but in all reality, this is how it was for me. It was basically a shift from what you see to the left to what you see to the right. And it was my first time in Ladakh. I was sent up there to manage a wildlife lodge, and I was given about 3-4 months to learn about the place and learn about what exactly goes on in Ladakh as wildlife. And I was totally thrown out of my comfort zone. And it was daunting at the start, but I slowly got used to it. A little bit about Ladakh. This is what all of you know as Ladakh. It is this beautiful, vast mountain range with a huge, broad valley, is the Blue Indus flowing through, and towering monasteries dotted across the landscape with small villages and very cheerful, happy people. That's what Ladakh is for most of the world. You can see that Buddhism was the most important form of faith in that. And the people practiced Buddhism, and they were cheerful, and it was not just a religion, but it was a way of life for them. It was more in sync with what they do every day and how they spend their time at home. It was very interesting for me, because I spent most of my childhood in Chennai, and then I spent a lot of time in Madhya Pradesh. But so it was as interesting for me being an Indian as it would be for someone who's coming from abroad. But this perception of Ladakh was great, but the first thing that hit me about Ladakh was, where are the people? I mean, the people were scattered in few pockets here and there, and most of the population was in Leh. And when I looked up the population density stats, Ladakh had a population density of less than 3 people per square kilometer. That's unimaginable in India. So basically what I saw Ladakh to be was 90,000 square kilometers of national park, of wilderness, whatever you want to call it. It was just open for exploration. And It's like I was saying, these villages are dotted through the landscape, but most of Ladakh is not exactly inhabited. And that was, it was great that the whole thing was open to exploration. There was less population and all of that. But it was also a very extreme place, Ladakh. I mean, you can see that we were almost at an altitude of 4,000 meters or 3,800 to 4,000 meters at an average. So because it was that high and that far north, it was a very cold in the winters. And because of the altitude, the sun was very, very intense in the summer months. So the first perception that I got when I went there was, the place was lifeless. I mean, I was like, what am I going to do here? I loved my time in Central India with the trees, the frogs, butterflies. What am I exactly going to do here? And then all I realized over time that it's only about taking a closer look, as I put out over there. It was just taking notice of things and getting used to the landscape, getting your eyes used to the landscape. That's what it was about. And yes, this is the animal that I went there to spend time with, and I have never seen one before. When I went to Ladakh the first time, I'd never seen a snow leopard. I never imagined that I'll see one, even during the time that I went there. And for those who couldn't see it in the frame, I put an arrow over there. That's a snow leopard perched beautifully on a rocky mountainside amongst snow. You can see that even though it's sitting in the open, it's so easy to miss it and drive by, and that's probably why Ladakh looks lifeless, because the animals in Ladakh, even though they're in the open, blend in so beautifully with the surroundings. And it took me some time to get used to this. And once I got used to this, it was fantastic to see that there was fantastically special adaptations of mammals and even a lot of different other life forms to these extreme conditions. But before we actually jump into the biodiversity or the wildlife, let's first understand what makes Ladakh the Indian Trans-Himalaya. What is the Trans-Himalaya? So to do this, we'll probably have to jump back about 50 million years before us now, when the Indian plate kind of broke off from the southern landmass and started drifting north to hit the Eurasian plate. And as it went and hit the Asian plate about 35 million years ago, roughly, what happened was there was a huge push up of land, which happened, which basically was the birth of the Himalayas. The Himalayas was born about 35 million years ago, as most of you would have read in school. It's one of the youngest mountain ranges in the world. But what it did to the climate and to the landscape of Asia was, I think, quite phenomenal, because without the Himalaya, what happens is, the green you see to the south of the white mountain range of the image wouldn't have been there. And India would have been a dry desert, because if the Himalayas wasn't there, the monsoon winds wouldn't have been blocked. And the Terai and the Gangetic Plain wouldn't have existed if not for the Himalayas. But what it also did was made the land to the north of the Himalayas very, very dry. As you can see, it's all brown out there. And that is what is the Trans-Himalaya. So when you go there now, you can still see areas where the seismic activity that was 35 million years old, and people still believe it's happening now also at a much slower or on a geological scale. You can actually see the suture zone, as they call it, the place where the continents met. You can still see the activity that went about to create this landscape. And one of the best ways to notice the difference between the Himalaya and the Trans-Himalaya, it's not always very clear, but when you take a plane journey from Delhi to Leh, which is about an hour, halfway through the journey, you'll see a point where the snow on the mountaintops becomes less, and then the whole landscape becomes a whole lot more browner. That, to an extent, is where the Himalaya-Trans-Himalaya divide is. Actually the boundary is a gray area. You can't actually define it, but you can roughly say that where you see this visual transition, that's where the Trans-Himalaya starts. And this is just a more zoomed in view of the Trans-Himalaya, especially pertaining to Ladakh. You can see the red dot to the right of the label that says Jammu and Kashmir. That is Ladakh. That entire chunk with the snow peaks and the plateau to the east and the Karakorams to the north and the Indus Valley in the middle, that whole chunk is Ladakh, the Transhimalaya of India. So for a lot of people, Ladakh would be like this whole area which is full of mountains. But unfortunately or fortunately, it is not. It is actually as varied a landscape as any other landscape in the world. It is a cold desert, yes, but it is a cold desert that has mountains, that has brackish water lakes, high plateaus, broad valleys, scrub jungle, grasslands. It has a huge mix of landscapes that make Ladakh. But for all practical purposes, I'd like to say Ladakh can be divided into five distinct habitats. This is not actually something that is accepted. This is just my division, and it has helped me look at Ladakh in a more, with a little bit more clarity, you can say. Let's start with the most obvious one, the mountains. The mountains of Ladakh is something, I mean, it's very hard to explain in words. It is the most shriveled ecosystem that one can encounter. It is not like any of the beautiful, easy to look at mountains of the Himalayas, or like you see in Kumaon or Garhwal or the Alps for that matter. Here, the mountains are form so many different patterns and shapes. There are like craggy cliffs, there is sharp ridges, very, very narrow mountain paths. It's not exactly what you would say as conducive or comforting to the eye. But once you go there, you get used to it, and the whole landscape kind of grows on you. And of course, the mountains is where the hero of Ladakh, as some people call it, or the gray ghost of the mountains, the snow leopard, resides in these mountains. I mean, the last time I didn't speak much about the snow leopard because I wanted the attention to be spread through the spectrum of wildlife of Ladakh. But because of a lot of feedback, I've just included a few interesting facts about snow leopards, you can say. Basically, snow leopards, what they do in these mountains is they're not all over the place in the mountains. Even for them, certain terrain is difficult to cross. What they generally do is walk the high mountain ridges. Basically, that's their highway. And where it's conducive for them to come down, if necessary, they come down to the valley floors to cross over to the next set of mountains. So they don't actually walk in the valley floor or spend most of their time in the valley floor. What they do is they spend their time in the ridges because they also have an advantage of a vantage point, and also they mostly hunt by chasing prey down from the higher reaches. So they actually prefer chasing prey down and sometimes even tripping them to fall and break their necks, especially if it's larger prey like ibex. So snow leopards, contrary to popular belief, they're not everywhere. They are everywhere, but they have very specific routes that they take in these mountains. And seeing one obviously is not easy. In this picture is a good example of it. What is happening here is to the right of the frame, I don't know if all of you can see it. I'm going to go to the next slide where I have put some arrows to help you out. There's a pair of snow leopards mating. And to the extreme left of the frame, there is the female's two-year-old cub, which is watching this happen. This sounds exciting once you see it, but exciting things are happening all the time in Ladakh, and they're happening at such distances that it makes it very, very hard to capture them or even observe them unless you have a trained eye. But when you have kills happening, like for example, in this picture, you can see a snow leopard has taken down an ibex. And like I said, they chase them down the mountains through these valleys where we have gullies. I don't know if all of you understand the term gully. You know, it's like a narrow, smooth area. That's where they chase the prey down. And then so most of these kills happen in the valley floor. What happens is when they make the kill in the valley floor, it makes it a lot more easier for us to access them and get a little closer. And naturally, the snow leopard is a whole lot bolder when it's on a kill. But having said that, there is also a lot of problems because, like I said, Ladakh, the people, these small hamlets are distributed throughout the mountains, and snow leopards, like in any other big cat, do come in contact with people. And there is a lot of livestock which is being killed in a lot of Ladakh, and there is a retaliatory killing which happens because of that. For example, this picture, you can see there's a snow leopard which has got into a sheep pen, and it had killed almost all the 40 sheep which was there inside. That is a farmer's, you can say his entire lives, his entire earning and income was had disappeared in one night. And so there is a lot of remorse in among some communities for the snow leopard. So it took a lot of time and a lot of constant conversation to make sure the kind of these kind of negative impressions about these cats were alleviated. And we also needed a solution to make sure this wasn't rampant. So it was very easy. Most of the cattle corrals in Ladakh are open to the from the top. And the villagers never bothered closing it because wood wasn't easily available. So it was not easy for them to build a shelter on the top. So they just built a stone corral, which was open from above. So it made it easy for the snow leopard to get in and out. So the Snow Leopard Conservancy did something fantastic where they funded most of the money to put out these wire meshes on top. And surprisingly enough, a simple solution like this reduced the conflict by almost 95%, which is all it needed was a simple solution. And yeah, and snow leopards have ever since done well. The conflict has reduced. One can often come across mothers with cubs, and you can see, basically you can say, roughly like a tiger, there is about three or four females in the territory of a male. But territories over here are not really defined as far as I've seen, because what generally happens is I've seen over six different snow leopards marking in the same spot. Unlike tigers, we don't know exactly which individual is who, because the markings aren't that easy to read, especially at those distances. But there is a general consensus that territories do overlap for snow leopards. So it was nice to look at the snow leopard, see it, photograph it, and all of that. But the snow leopard is there in that landscape because of a multitude of factors, one of which is a good population of Himalayan ibex, which is a large mountain goat that occupies these cliffs. And the ibex are fantastic, fantastically adapted to these conditions. I mean, one can say that for them, a steep vertical slope is as easy to navigate as a flat surface. I mean, sometimes you see the ibex doing what they do best on the mountaintops or on the cliffs, and you can't believe that they're doing it. They have this low center of gravity because of their short legs, and they also have very adaptable rubbery hooves, which makes it easy for them to hold on to even the most narrow of precipices. And so the ibex, yes, you can say one of their responses to danger is to get onto these cliffs where it is hard even for a snow leopard sometimes to get access to them. Another wild ungulate, which is a hoofed animal basically, of the region is the burrell. A lot of people call it blue sheep. I'm not really sure why they call it blue sheep. I've never seen an individual that's blue in color. But they are, for us, it is, you can call them burrell, B-H-A-R-A-L, as you can see. And these are sheep, unlike ibex, which is a goat. And one of the best ways to tell a sheep from a goat is the presence or absence of a long beard in the males. There are other differences also, but that gets a little too technical, so I don't want to get into that. This is a burrell female. And of course, whenever you have these tall mountains and temperature differences, you're going to have thermal currents. And when you have thermal currents, there are going to be a lot of big raptors. The most popular and the most enigmatic of the lot is the golden eagle. It's a large raptor, very powerful raptor, which can take down anything from a small woolly hare or a partridge to, I've seen them even go for young ibex and blue sheep. And I've also seen one attempt to take a snow leopard cub, but was chased away by the mother. I mean, seeing a golden eagle soar through these mountains is quite a spectacular experience. But another raptor which is equally important is the one to the left, the bearded vulture or the lammergeier. The lammergeier is specialized in feeding on the bone marrow. So it actually lets the golden eagle, the foxes, the griffon vulture in the middle, they all do the hard work of going through the carcass And when the bones are left, the lamagayas usually sweep in over there, take it, fly high, drop the bones on rocks, and when they shatter, they go down and feed on the marrow. So they specialize as marrow feeders, the lamagayas. And of course, there are a lot of other bird life in the mountains specialized to these conditions. One is the Himalayan snowcock and the Tibetan snowcock. Basically, birds look like big fat chicken. They generally stick to the high mountain ridges where you can hear them calling often, but seeing one is not easy. Their call is almost like that of a black kite, for those who are familiar with the call of a black kite. So basically, guys, one other thing. I'm seeing a lot of people ask questions. I'm going to get to the questions at the end of the session. So I would suggest all of you send it after the talk is over, because it's hard to do both at the same time. So yeah, so these snowcocks generally stick to the mountaintops, but when there is heavy snowfall, you can see them coming down to the closer to the valley floors. That's when I got these images. One of the birds that I really wanted to see when I went to Ladakh was the chukar partridge. It's actually known as just the chukar. And I didn't expect to see so many when I went there. It is actually a beautiful bird, but it's also one of the most common birds. You can see them inside Leh town. You can see them around villages. They're all over the place. And they come in big flocks. You can see them flying constantly, chattering. And they actually form a big, a very essential part of the food chain for raptors and small carnivores of the region. Of course, when you have big birds, you're going to have small birds also, like the horned lark. You can see it gets its name from the small horn that you can see to the side of the head. The hill pigeon on top, which looks very similar to our common pigeon that you see in Delhi everywhere, but it can be told apart by the white on the tail. And also you have a separate family of birds called accenters, which specialize in thriving on steep mountain slopes where they feed on grain, dormant larvae, pupa of insects. They feed on a variety of things. And when you have large carnivores, there is also always in every habitat around the world, there are secretive small carnivores and other small animals. One of them, which is very hard to see, is the one to the left, which is the stone marten. It is actually the only marten in our country which is truly nocturnal. And they actually come into the villages at night to feed amongst the people's storages, and they also hunt a lot in the night. We see them a lot in camera traps, but I have seen two individuals in my last 4 years in Ladakh. But the one in the middle, the mountain weasel, is basically the mountain weasel in the middle is something that you can see a lot more frequently because it is extremely active through the day. And it's a small animal, but it is so active and so ferocious that it can take even larger prey. Like you can see this one feeding on a wall, but I've seen them feed on pikas also, which is almost as big as them. And sometimes they hunt in small coalitions of 2 to 3 animals. And they do come often towards the villages in search of mice. Seeing one is always a very special. You can also, some people say there is also the stoat or the ermine, which is another kind of weasel in the region, but I've never seen it. But there are some images of the animal in Ladakh, but I've never seen it. It is basically told apart by the larger size and the black tipped tail. The animal on the right is a very special one. It's actually a pika. A pika is basically a cross between a hare and a mouse. And you can see that quite clearly. It looks like a rabbit or a hare, but it has ears like a mouse. And these animals, you can see where there's a lot of large boulders where they form tunnels through them. And they store a lot of roots, seed, tubers, grain, all of them as larders inside their stockpiles, which are kept inside the rocks. And they're active through the year, actually, and unlike most of the other smaller mammals, which tend to hibernate, these animals are active throughout. In the winters, they come out when the sun is there, and they are active for lesser time. But because they have the stockpile of food under the rocks, they are able to survive, and they don't feel the need to hibernate. That is it about the mountains. I mean, there is of course a lot more, but there. For now, I'm going to say that is it about the mountains. The next one is the large plateau to the east of Ladakh. So Changthang, as it's called, literally translates to the western extension. It'll be confusing as to why a plateau to the east is called the western extension. The explanation is very simple. The plateau is actually the western extension of the Tibetan plateau that comes into Ladakh. So though it is on the east of Ladakh, over the years in the past, it was considered to be the western extension of Tibet. So now it's called the Changtang Plateau. So this is a very, very different landscape with very smooth rolling hills, flat plateaus. And some areas are so flat that you can actually drive blindfolded in any direction and you will not even feel a bump. It's a very, very interesting landscape, and photographically it's great. It has its own specialized wildlife, which we'll talk about now. The most charismatic and the most well-known of the wildlife in the Changtang Plateau is, of course, the Tibetan wild ass, or the Kiang. Despite the name where it's called the wild ass, some people believe it is more closely related to horses because the hair on the tail extends right from the start, unlike a donkey, which has hair only at the tip of the tail. So it is actually closer to horses than asses. For all practical purposes now, it's called the Tibetan wild ass or the Kiang. These are basically social animals, except the stallion lives by his own. But the mares and the young ones, the foals, form small herds of about, you can say, I've seen about 12 to 15 maximum. And they are often seen in the flatter parts of Ladakh where there's a lot of pasture land. They do cross over the rolling hills to get between pasture lands, but their habitat essentially is the flat grasslands of Changtang Plateau. This is probably one of the rarer mammals of Ladakh. It is found in only one particular plateau on the extreme eastern limit of Ladakh in a village called Hanle. There's a plateau about an hour drive from Hanle called Kala Taltal. And that's where you get the Tibetan gazelle. Interestingly, the local name of the Tibetan gazelle is Goa, like the state. So this animal, there are probably about 40 to 50 individuals in Ladakh, and most of them are in this plateau. There is about a neighboring plateau where there's a few individuals also. And they prefer to stay in this very windy, arid plateaus where their speed is their biggest advantage from predators. And also what happens is they have a very thick fur, so it helps them survive despite the extreme cold conditions. And I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with the chinkara or the Indian gazelle that you get in the deserts of Rajasthan and Gujarat. But the Tibetan gazelle, like the chinkara, actually survives almost its entire life without going for water. So the vegetation has a little bit of moisture inside, and that is enough for them to survive. Of course, when you have flat open areas, you're going to have the wolf, of course. World over, northern hemisphere, habitats like this have or originally did have wolves before they were hunted out. So wolves in Ladakh, the Tibetan wolf, the Latin name goes like Canis lupus shanku. The shanku is a term derived from the local name of the wolf, which is shanku. These wolves are actually scattered throughout the landscape across all habitats, but overall they do prefer flat open areas because they generally hunt by chasing prey over long distances and tiring them out. So they're more built to survive in vast open terrains and not built to climb cliffs to bring down ibex like the snow leopard. So these guys actually do chases, some of which can go up to 5 to 6 kilometers or even more, by which time the prey is so exhausted that it collapses and the wolves go for it at the end. Here is a rare image of a pack of wolves. Unfortunately, you don't see many packs in Ladakh because the populations of wolves are almost heavily persecuted across the landscape because of the heavy predation on livestock. So the wolves are overall poisoned in most of Ladakh. And also there is a problem with wolves is the snow leopard, being the apex big cat, takes away a lot of the attention. So people generally don't talk about wolves or the problems of wolves or the conservation of wolves, at least in Ladakh. So they have been ignored and they have been persecuted heavily. But in some areas, you can still see packs where, to an extent, I would say in my personal experience, tourism, wildlife tourism has kind of taken a foothold and the people have been benefited by wildlife. So they realize that having wolves and snow leopards around their villages is good for them. So that generally translates to saving wildlife also and kind of stops the persecution or the retaliatory killing by the villagers. Of course, the red fox, probably the one of the most widely distributed canids in the world. It's found across the entire northern hemisphere of the world, almost 52 to 53 subspecies world over. And in the Himalayas, of course, it's called the Himalayan red fox. They are actually found across all the habitats of Ladakh, but you can see them a lot more in the Changthang Plateau, simply because it's a flat open terrain. The foxes are always moving around in search of food, unlike the mountains where they can move through the rocks and the different slopes of the mountains, so you can't see them most of the time. And usually in the mountains, you see foxes only when there's a kill, because they're a scavenger, they come through the carcass. And if you can locate a carcass in time, you can definitely see a fox coming to it. This bird is also probably one of the rarer partridges of Ladakh. It's called the Tibetan partridge, locally called the Dreshak. What is special about this partridge is it is mostly seen only in the winter months, because in the summers, they go to the higher ridges of Ladakh, almost above 5,000 meters to breed. Unlike the other partridges which don't go so high, this one exhibits a unique altitudinal movement for breeding. So they actually, you can sometimes see them in the high passes of Changthang Plateau in the summer months. But in the winters, it makes it very easy to see them. They come to the valley floors and they hang around villages and they're very easily approachable. But contradictory to what happens in the winters, the summers, they just disappear. And you can look very hard to find them, but it is usually very, very hard to see the Tibetan partridges in the summer months. So when you have a specialized extreme habitat like Changthang, you're going to have specialist adaptations, one of which is the Hume's ground pecker. You can see, as soon as you see the bird, the first thing that strikes you is the large head and the large beak. And that is simply because these birds depend heavily on the food that is hidden under the pebbles and the stones. So what they do is they use their powerful neck muscles and their beak to keep tossing pebbles around to look for larvae and insects that are hiding below. And again, this bird is something which I have seen only in the summer months, and I honestly don't know what happens to them in the winter. They are seen in the summer, and the books don't say they migrate anywhere, but I haven't seen them in the winter months. This is a family all of you are familiar with throughout India. Even in the big cities, you see them, which is crows. But crows are special in Ladakh because you do have a lot of species of crows over there. All of them are interesting, of course, world over. But in Ladakh, you actually take notice of the fact that they're interesting. The one on the right is the carrion crow, which is very similar to a large-bill crow which you get in our forests of Madhya Pradesh or throughout India. But the best way to tell them apart is the flat forehead that they have. And this bird is actually quite rare and often overlooked because of its similarities of appearance with the large-bill crow. But unlike the carrion crow, the bird to the left is probably the most unmistakable of the crow family. It's the northern raven. And this bird is almost as big as a buzzard, and it flies like a raptor with huge wings. And when you see it flying, you can be sure that it's a raven and not any other raptor or a crow. And a large beak is often a telltale sign also. The ravens, basically, you can see them following nomadic herders in the Changthang Plateau or around carcasses or around villages in the higher plateaus. You don't generally see them much in the mountains. I'm not exactly sure why, but you do see them a lot in the plateau landscape. So this is probably my favorite animal from the plateau landscape, which is Changthang. I'm going to refer to it as Changthang henceforth. This is the largest wild sheep in the world. It's the Tibetan Argali, best told because of its large size, of course. It is almost as big as a horse. And another key way to identify it is the shape of the horns. The horns actually curve twice in this animal, unlike the other sheep of Ladakh. And this is the animal in its summer coat, of course, with the brown and the very shaggy white neck and behind. But in the winters, they actually, I've never seen it myself because I've not been able to see one in the winter months. They actually form a beautiful white, smooth bib around their neck, and the body turns a dark gray to black. So it actually looks like a majestic, large sheep, very different to what you see in this picture, which is the summer representation. And of course, in Changtang, you have its own species of pika. This is the Ladakh pika with the gray, the black muzzle and the low set ears, which is a telltale adaptation to the colder conditions. And this Ladakh, you can say, has about four species of pika, and there is a lot of taxonomical ambiguity amongst pikas. But this one you can see in the high plateaus of Ladakh. And they generally, you can see them in open areas where they live in these burrows, and they come out to feed around the burrows in the grasses. So Ladakh, as most of you know, is bordering, of course, Tibet, but which is now controlled by the Chinese. I don't know what the right way to say it is, but I'm going to say it's controlled. It is the Chinese border. So most of you know that a lot of Ladakh is under conflict, especially towards the Chinese border area. And a whole lot of land is under army control or in actual Chinese control, like Aksai Chin. So because of that, the part of the plateau, some of the valleys in the plateau are lost to this conflict. And actually, in those areas, you have the wild yak, the Tibetan antelope, and the Tibetan sand fox. Unfortunately, it's very hard to see them here because you don't get access to these places. And even if you do, it becomes very hard to see them because so very few people go there to see it that not much is known about their distribution inside these plateaus. I know some people who have gone with the army and seen them, so that's why you've seen them here in the presentation. In fact, I've actually seen a Tibetan sand fox in one part of Changtang, but very, very rare again. I'm going to tell you more about the Tibetan antelope later because it has a very interesting natural history, which is actually one of the conservation problems of Ladakh, but we'll get to that later. The animal to the left is a wild yak. You do see yaks throughout Ladakh, but almost all of them are feral or owned by the villagers for their thick fur and also to mate with cows to form a cross called the dzo, which is the most preferred domestic animal of Ladakh. So the yaks that you see as you drive through the roads in Ladakh are not wild. The original wild gene pool is found in one particular valley called Changchenmo in the eastern extreme, almost northeastern extreme of Ladakh. So wild yak again is found there and of course into Tibet after that, but within Ladakhi limits, it's not very easy to see. Of course, this niche is actually a habitat niche which is found inside the Changtang Plateau, but I would like to look at it as something different simply because of the richness of life that is found here. This is the high altitude lakes and wetlands. Most of this is brackish, but you do have some freshwater lakes also here. And these areas are not very active in the winter months because most of them are frozen. But in the summer, it is like a heaven for wildlife. It is a beautiful, beautiful hotspot for birds and a lot of different mammals which we'll talk about now. It is also an important birding area and a Ramsar site because of the birds that come and breed here. Some of the most, probably the most important and the most charismatic of the species that comes here is the black-necked crane that you can see to the right. These birds arrive at Ladakh in the early summer months and they breed around these lakes in the shallows, usually using the reeds for cover. And they feed amongst the lakes and you can see them usually till September or October before, after which they fly back. It is believed that they fly eastwards back into Tibet, but it is not sure. Some people say a population from Ladakh goes all the way to Phobjika Valley in Bhutan, but I'm not sure about the whether it's actually true that they do such a long migration. The bar-headed geese that you can see to the bottom left of the frame, it's a very interesting bird because it is one of the highest altitudinal flyers in the world. So people have seen bar-headed geese flying over Mount Everest. That's how well they've adapted to fly over the mountains. And whenever you see a bar-headed geese in India, you say, yeah, this bird has crossed the Himalayas to come here. But contrary to popular belief, most of the bar-headed geese don't go all the way crossing the high peaks. They just cross a part of the low Himalaya, which separates India, mainland India from Ladakh. And they breed actually in Ladakh instead of actually going all the way to Tibet and Mongolia, which is the popular belief. So a lot of bar-headed geese breed in lakes like Somoriri, Sokar, Pangong, and a lot of these marshes, along with ruddy shell duck and a whole lot of other geese. The great crested grebe also can be seen here. They form beautiful mound nests inside the water. And if you come probably in May or June, you can see them display by running over water to attract the mates, the females. The Tibetan sand grouse is also found in the dry ground, which is there around the lakes. And again, a bird which is not very much is known about the Tibetan sand grouse, because I've seen it, you can say, for a few months in summer, and then they tend to disappear, and I don't really know where they've gone. I actually saw a recent picture of Tibetan sand grouse in Kibber village in Himachal Pradesh in the peak winter. So I don't know what they do so high up in the mountains, because that is not a habitat you'll associate with the Tibetan sand grouse based on what you see in Ladakh. So a lot of things is still unknown about the Tibetan sand grouse. So this animal, the Pallas's cat, is probably the holy grail of wildlife, at least for me in Ladakh. I have always seen the pictures in Vivek Menon's book, and I've been fascinated by the animal, but I was never thought that I'll go there and see it. It took me a while to find or locate one of these cats, and they generally tend to hang around the rocky conglomerates surrounding these marshes. So there are rocks with holes or small caves in them, like the one to the right, and the cats live inside them, and they come out to hunt birds, small rodents, pikas, and then they disappear back into these holes. And some of them also use the holes excavated on the ground by marmots. So this, the first time I saw one was a great, it's probably one of the, it was a very interesting experience for me, because the animal was sitting inside a cave like this. And then when it stepped out, it was this huge cylindrical ball of fur. And I couldn't see any legs. The tail was there and I couldn't really see a head. It was just like as if something was levitating over the rock, because the legs are small and there is so much fur hanging down the side of the body that it takes you a while to understand what you're exactly looking at. And the most interesting feature of the Pallas's cat is the ears. They have these large droopy ears which don't rise above the head, unlike most other big cats. And the Latin name actually goes as Ontocolobus manul. Ontocolobus in Latin translates to ugly ears. I don't know why Mr. Pallas thought it has ugly ears. I think it has beautiful ears, but that's what the Latin name translates to. Ontocolobus manul, the Pallas's cat. This animal, probably you can say, lives in marshes at 4,500 meters throughout the plateau. And it has also been recorded in some high altitude meadows amongst the mountains where similar conditions or microhabitats exist. But again, not much is known about this cat species within Indian limits. Most of the studies have been done in the Mongolian steppe, but within India, not much is known about it. And with regards to size, it's, you can say, as tall as a little shorter than a jungle cat, because it has short legs, but it is a very long animal. You can say it's as long as a fox, like the Bengal fox that you see throughout India, about 2 feet long, two and a half feet long. Yeah. And of course, when you have so much of life, birds nesting and brackish water marshes, you're going to have raptors like the Eurasian eagle owls, which nest in the lichen-covered rocks of Ladakh. Sakir falcons come there to breed, and they feed extensively on the birds that breed in the marshes. Little owls, of course, feed on the smaller larks and rodents, and they also can be seen in the in more like boulders. They occupy boulders around the lake, and they can be seen perched in the open like this throughout the day. And of course, the upland buzzard, best told, it looks very similar to a Himalayan buzzard or a long-legged buzzard. But one of the ways to tell them is the dark leg feathers that it has, or the tarsus, is one of the best way to tell the upland buzzard apart from the other buzzards. So these birds, actually, you can see them sitting in the grassland by the holes of these animals, the vole, B-O-L-E, This is a silvery mountain bull. And this animal probably is the basic construct of the Trans-Himalayan, or not the Trans-Himalayan, I would say these brackish water lakes. Without these animals, so many birds and raptors wouldn't come here, because these animals are found in such high numbers that there's food for the cranes, the raptors, and they also loosen up the soil heavily for by their digging for the insects, which feed a whole lot of other birds, which again sustains a separate ecosystem. So these voles are often preyed upon by the little owls and the eagle owls and the sakir falcon, not the falcon, you say the upland buzzard. And the upland buzzard does it in a very interesting way. It doesn't swoop down and catch the vole or anything. It just waits casually by one of these hole openings. And when the vole pops out like this, it just jumps and catches it. And usually when you see an upland buzzard sitting on the ground, you can be pretty sure that that's what it's up to. And again, there is a whole lot of other bird life, like I told you. A specialist amongst them is the Tibetan lark, which is found only in a very few select marshes in the eastern extreme of the Changthang Plateau. Apart from them, a lot of the mainland birds like the red-throated pipit and the desert wheatear, which we might be familiar with from our birding experiences in Western India, they also come in their breeding plumages here and breed in these high-altitude marshes. The Mongolian finch is a very, very beautiful bird, as you can see to the top right, the pink color. The pink color is mostly seen in the summer months. In the winter, it looks like a very pale pink brown bird. And in the winter, actually, it spreads throughout Ladakh. But in the summer months, I've seen it only close to these marshes. This, we are moving on to the next habitat niche. Again, nothing concrete. This is not a concrete habitat niche. The valleys of the Indus and the Shayok. I look at them as a separate entity simply because of the amount of development that has happened there. These are the only two valleys with large, fast-flowing rivers. And also, these are the valleys with the most number of roads, villages, army camps. So there is a lot of conservation importance for these two valleys. It may not have significance in terms of the biodiversity, but in terms of the conservation aspect of things, it is very important. Especially for this animal. This is the Ladakh Uriel, or the Uriel, I'm not sure what the pronunciation is, but it's one of the wild sheep that is restricted to these two valleys. This sheep can be found only along the Indus Valley or the Shayok Valley and a few of the valleys that branch out from these main Indus and Shayok valleys. So you can see these sheep, as compared to the Argali or the Baral or the Ibex, have experience the brunt of the development that happens in Ladakh. For example, their source of water, which is apart from the smaller springs, the Indus and the Shayok rivers, is mostly cut off because there are roads on both sides of these rivers. And also because of development, there's a lot of feral dogs in Ladakh. And because of that, there's a lot of predation by the dogs towards these sheep as they descend to the lower areas to drink water. There is also a lot of conflict with villagers, with farmlands. There is conflict with even traffic. Unlike most of the other wildlife, you can say that this animal is heavily affected by the traffic that moves on the roads. So I would say the most persecuted animal in Ladakh, despite contrary to popular belief that people think it's a snow leopard, the wolf of course is affected, but with as a direct consequence of the development that's happening in Ladakh, the Uriel is probably the most, is probably at the highest risk. This is of course, a young male and a female. You can tell them apart quite easily by their whitish legs, the differently shaped horns and the black on the sides of the body and the neck ruff. Having said that, for someone who hasn't been to Ladakh or who's looking at these animals the first time, all the sheep and goat will look similar. So it is only like any other thing, it's only practice. So if you keep looking at them, you can tell quite easy that you're looking at longer legs, a unique shaped horn, a more reddish color is a Uriel. Shorter legs, gray fur, horns which curve outwards, it's a Baral. The Argali, of course, much bigger animal with horns that curve twice, it is an Argali. Also, the females can be difficult, but if you keep looking at them and keep referring your books every time you look at one instead of assuming, you might be able to tell the difference quite easily soon enough. So, this is the Indus River and the Shayok Rivers are probably one of the few places in India where you can be sure that when you see an otter, it's a Eurasian otter. Of course, Eurasian otter looks very similar to a smooth-coated otter except for the shape of the muzzle. So in a lot of places, you can be confused as to what you're looking at. But when you come to Ladakh and you see the blue water and an otter swimming in these waters, you can be sure that's a Eurasian otter. These animals kind of prefer to occupy the slow-moving stretches of the river, especially where the river forms deep pools. And that's where they go diving down to catch the fish that are hiding amongst the subaquatic rocks. And basically, when they come out, they feed on the fish. They sunbathe on the banks like any other otter does. But what is interesting is these otters also come on to frozen sections of the river in the winter months to sunbathe over there. So sometimes you can see an otter sitting in the open amongst a frozen lake or a frozen stretch of river, just sitting on its back and taking in the sun. It is not something that is seen often. I mean, the otters are seen probably 2-3 times in Ladakh in a year by different people, simply because they've become so rare. I'm not sure what the reasons are. It could be the damming of the river. It could be climate change. It could also be a lot of persecution by poachers for their pelt. So with regards to otters, we actually don't know much what their problems are in Ladakh. I've seen the otter twice or thrice, but that's as far as my knowledge goes of otters in Ladakh. When you have fast-flowing rivers, like I said about the Indus and the Shayok, you're going to have birds that specialize in moving water, unlike the birds which we saw earlier, which specialize in stagnant water. One of the most important birds that one needs to look out for along the Indus and the Shayok is the bird to the left. It's a beautiful ibisbill. It's a bird that you can generally overlook because of the gray color, and it sits still in the pebbles around these rivers, and it makes it very hard to see. But when they're active in the shallow stretches of the river, moving amongst the pebbles and feeding on subaquatic insects, and that's what they do. Ibisbills move to the lower latitudes around Corbett and Nameri in the winter months, but there is also a part of the population that stays back in Ladakh. I'm not sure why that adaptation has happened or how many years it's been happening, but there is a population of ibisbill that tends to stay back, which a lot of people don't know. Another bird that specializes in fast-flowing rivers, especially the rapids, is the gooseander or the common merganser that you can see in the top, in the middle. So the common merganser or gooseander thrives in the rapids. In fact, even the chicks, as soon as they come out and hit the water, they're easily moving through these rapids, which probably even an expert swimmer would find it hard, because these rapids move through rocks and the merganser is able to navigate them quite easily. And this bird is a male, of course. The female has a more orangish head and a brown back. Mallards, again, most of you will be familiar if you've birded around any of the wetlands in northern India. But they are actually another bird that breed in the Oxbow Lakes and the rivers of the Indus. Bitterns, water rails, crakes, a whole lot of birds visit Ladakh in the summers. If you were wondering what happens to these winter migrants in Delhi or Kutch or any place, suddenly they disappeared in March. You can be sure that most of these birds have come to places like Ladakh, in Ladakh and Tibet, to breed in the reeds around the Indus and other freshwater marshes. In fact, there's a beautiful wetland in Sheh, which is about 20 minutes from Leh. It's a wetland called Sheh, S-H-E-Y, Sheh marshes. But most of that area, unfortunately, got covered by debris in the 2011 floods. So most of these birds which used to be seen over there have dispersed to other areas. So it can be hard to see them, but if you find the right habitat, you can be sure that you can see a water rail or a great bittern or a little bittern or a ruddy-breasted crake, and things like that. The bird to the right is again found throughout the mountains, but I've seen it more often along the Indus and the Shayok, especially in the steep gorges that the rivers flow through. Is the wall creeper. The best way to to describe this bird is, can everyone hear me? I've got a message saying the people can't hear me. Okay, Nelson, I think there's something wrong with your audio. You might have to figure it out. Okay, so like I was saying, a friend of mine described this bird in the most beautiful way. He called it an avian butterfly. An avian butterfly because when it's sitting and the wings are basically folded up, you just look at it as a gray bird with a little bit of black on the wings. But when it expands its wings to take off, It is like a butterfly taking off. You know, it's a burst of color, red, white, and black. And they fly in this bobbing manner like a butterfly, and they land on another vertical surface. Usually they land in moist vertical surfaces because they have a lot more insect larvae and a lot more food for them. So these birds, as the name suggests, crawl over vertical surfaces. And also they come down to the pebbles by the Indus and the Shayok. A small population of these birds also migrates to the Kumaon and Garhwal and Corbett and other lower altitude areas. But there is a population which stays back in Ladakh in the winter months. Of course, another special bird that is restricted to this place is the solitary snipe. You do get them in similar habitats in Arunachal and Nepal and Tibet, but Ladakh, you can say, is one of the special places for this bird. It is the highest high altitude breeding snipe, and probably the snipe which breeds at the highest altitude or lives at the highest altitude world over. The common snipe, pintailed snipe, also come into Ladakh in the summer months, but unlike them, the solitary snipe stays here through the year. They move altitudinally to the smaller rivulets that join the Indus. And in the winter months and also in the summer months, sometimes you can see them in the marshes around the Indus and the Shayok rivers. And very beautiful bird, very hard to see simply because they can sit motionless. And in fact, one of the most interesting things about these birds is they specialize in spring water. I'd like to explain the term spring water. In Ladakh, you have two different kinds of water sources. One is the glacial melt and one is spring water. So spring water tends to be warmer because it comes from hot springs or warm springs, as because they're not really that hot, as you can imagine. But these warm springs have a lot more life and they don't flow as heavily as the glacial rivers and streams. So what happens is these snipes generally prefer to stick around to these spring water pools, and you can generally look for them over there. In fact, the locals say if you want to see this bird, go to a chashma pani. That's what they call the spring water because it's crystal clear. It looks like a mirror or a chashma. It's called a chashma pani. And that's where you look for solitary snipes. I'm not sure why they call it solitary. I wish I knew, but I've generally seen the snipes alone. But you see most of the snipes alone. And very rarely in their wintering grounds, you see them together. So I'm not really sure what it means. It could be a parthenogenic snipe or something. I don't know. And of course, when you have so much of development, you're going to have birds that are well adapted to human surroundings. The two choughs to the right are a very common sight throughout Ladakh, the yellow-billed or the alpine chough and the red-billed chough. And you can often see them in huge flocks soaring the thermals in circles around open areas. And their loud calls are probably omnipresent throughout every habitat or every human-occupied habitat in Ladakh. They're mostly seed eaters and they feed a lot of grain. But once I have seen them come to a carcass and feed, but that's not a very common occurrence. But contrary to that, the bird to the left is the common magpie or the black-billed magpie. This bird behaves more like a crow than the other crows of the region. It is the first to occupy areas where food is available commonly, like villages. You can see this bird all over any small village. It is found in areas where there is a carcass or something is dead. It is found over there for sure. So anywhere where there is food available, the magpies colonize. So there is also a very interesting thing about the magpie. What happens is, so like I said, the magpies are found only in areas where there's heavy food availability. So what happens when you see a magpie on a high mountaintop or when you see it on a craggy cliff, much, much further away from human civilization? That is when you can be sure that there's something, either something is dead or there is a snow leopard around. So this is actually a sign, because a snow leopard is not very easily directly visible, but a brightly colored magpie is more easily visible through a scope or a binocular on the mountainside. So when you see a magpie in these strange places, that's actually one of our secrets to finding snow leopards. So when you see a magpie in these strange places, you can be sure that there is a large carnivore around. And that's actually one of the signs that we look out for as snow leopard trackers to find the cats. Well, coming to our last habitat, this again is not a defined habitat. It is a habitat that I have chosen because whenever you have huge clumps of bushes, some of these clumps can be a few kilometers long. They're usually the layberry bush, which is Hippophae, or Myricaria, which is another very red-colored bush. These bushes form impenetrable clusters, sometimes as big as, like I said, a few kilometers. And there is a lot of life that thrives inside these clusters. And some of these habitats are in Nubra Valley, where you see the sand dunes. And around these sand dunes, if you look at the picture to the right also, beyond the sand dunes, you can see a very green patch before the mountain starts. That's again a huge scrub habitat. These habitats also are not restricted to Nubra. Close to the high mountain passes, there's also another bush called Karagana tibetica, which has yellow flowers in the summers. They also form such thick bush conglomerates. And the reason I look at these bushy habitats as something different from a valley floor or a Shayok Valley or an Indus Valley is because of this animal to the left. One of the most beautiful cats in the world for sure. The tall ears, lack of any visible tail, longer hind legs, and that very stocky, stout build, the Eurasian lynx, thrives in such habitats. Lynx is an animal which hunts by ambush, so the thick bush cover gives it plenty of chances to go after prey like the Nubra pika or the hare that you see to the right, and even go after partridges. And in fact, I have observed lynx which sometimes can stay motionless for even up to a few days, waiting under the same bush for something unsuspecting to come across its path, and then it jumps on it, and then the rest of it is food for it, of course. And then sometimes they move between these shrub clumps. And when they move between these shrub clumps is when you can actually see them open, like the picture to the left. It's not my picture. It's a picture by a friend of mine, Imran, from Ladakh. But he was kind enough to share the picture to use in the presentation. Most of the sightings I've seen are very far away, or I've taken videos, so I don't have anything to show for this presentation. So yes, a very beautiful animal. The Eurasian lynx is found all the way from Ladakh, you can say, extending all the way to parts of Europe. And in the Americas, of course, you have the Canadian lynx. And in Spain, there's a specialist lynx called the Iberian lynx. So the lynx is a very special animal in these parts. And in Ladakh, again, not much is known about it. Some people believe that lynx in Nubra Valley is a different subspecies to the lynx in the Zanskar mountain range. But again, that is simply because of morphological characters. So I'm not sure anyone's actually done intensive DNA studies on the lynx. So when you have thick bush, of course, you're going to have a whole new set of birds, passerine birds, or birds which are perching birds, as they're called. These birds like rose finches, red starts, a lot of the birds that you see in the plains go to these thick bush habitats because it provides them the cover and the safety and also the food to nest in and bring about their younger ones. A specialist in this habitat, of course, is the bird to the right, the white-browed tit warbler. Definitely the most beautiful warbler in India, I can say. It's a joy to watch one every time you see one, but unfortunately, they do stick to these heavily covered bushes. So you can hear them often, but to see them, you have to be very patient and keep watching. And when they move between bushes, you can see them. They're generally a lot easier to see in the winter months because they spread across a larger area in search of food. But in the summers, you can be sure that in the Nubra Valley scrub patches, these birds can be found a lot over there breeding. Again, like I said, when you have a specialist habitat, you're going to have specialist carnivores like the merlin in the middle, which is like a falcon which feeds on small birds. You have short-eared owls, you have sparrowhawks, you have hobbies, kestrels, a whole lot of birds can be seen perched around these habitats to catch an unsuspecting bird or a rodent. One bird which is very special to this habitat in Ladakh is the bird to the top left of the screen, the rufous-tailed rock thrush or the common rock thrush. This bird stops over in such habitat in Ladakh in the months of June and September, you can say, as a passage migrant. And then there are records of this bird in Surat, in Jamnagar, in Kutch, and then they go over to the Indian Ocean Islands. So this bird stops over in 2-3 places in India, and one of the places is a village called Panamik, which is in Nubra Valley again, but it's also a village which has a lot of thick bush, which I described all this while. And if you go there in June or September, you have a very high chance of seeing the rufous-tailed or the common rockfish. Yes, so we have seen the five different habitats of Ladakh. It's been, I'm not sure how much of it got through, because if you haven't been to Ladakh, a lot of it can be very, can sound very complicated. I tried my best to make it simple, but it can be complicated, especially because it's such an alien landscape. And most of the animals and birds that you see here are different. But you can understand something a lot more easier is the four different climatic seasons of Ladakh. Unlike the rest of India, Ladakh, because it's beyond the Himalayas, it doesn't have the monsoon climate. It has actually a cold winter, a very well-defined spring season, summer, autumn, and again winter. So Ladakh in summer actually is the time when one can see the most amount of life in Ladakh. Unfortunately, snow leopard viewing is understood to be better in the winter months. So most of the wildlife enthusiasts come in the winter. But if you actually want to see the biodiversity of Ladakh, you need to come in the summer. For starters, the flowering, the flora is best observed in the summers. You can see the primulas here in Warila Pass. These primulas are seen again in these snow melt areas in the summer months. And you don't see anything of this sort in the winter. Probably the most striking flowering event of Ladakh is in the month of April, which is considered to be spring. That is the apricot blossom. I mean, all of you would have heard the cherry blossom events in Ladakh. This apricot blossom in cherry blossom events in Japan, sorry. But this apricot blossom of Ladakh is something quite beautiful, quite comparable to what you see in Japan. In fact, apricots are heavily grown by a lot of villagers. So there's a lot of apricot trees throughout the landscape, especially around villages. And in the winters, they're leafless, as most of you know. But then come the month of April, they all burst into this brilliant shade of pink. And the whole landscape can actually be dotted with pink if you get a right vantage point. And it's quite stunning. Apricots, which is something you eat, for those of you who don't know what an apricot is. And when you have flora, you're obviously going to have a whole lot more bumblebees, dragonflies, butterflies, marmots, which come out. There's also reptiles. Can you believe Ladakh has reptiles? At 12,000 feet, at surviving minus 30 degree temperatures in the winter months, and in the summers, at 4,500 meters or 3,800 meters to 4,500 meters, you do have a lot of reptiles. The most exciting for me was seeing the eastern cliff racer to the top left. But the more commonly seen reptiles are the rock agamas, both of which you can see to the right. In fact, wherever you get these rock agamas in very high numbers, you can be sure that the cliff racer is close by, because that's their main prey. So they chase these lizards across open terrain because of their speed, and they capture them by constricting them. You also have amphibians in Ladakh. You have about 8 species. Yes, I have seen a few, but the most special of them is the snow toad or the scutiger species. The snow toad actually has a special ability to form a cave inside snow. I mean, just to imagine it easily, you can think of it as a cave inside snow. And then they shut down their body, you know. There's almost a zero heart rate. And that's how they survive the winters. And when the snow thaws, the frogs also thaw along with it. And then they come out. Unfortunately, I've never been able to see a snow toad in Ladakh, at least live. But there was a small flash flood in 2017. And I saw a couple of these toads washed down dead to the valley floor, and that's when I saw them. So I might go looking for them the next time I'm in Ladakh. The snake to the bottom left is something I'm still confused about. It is the Himalayan pit viper. It is found more in the Himalayas, like in Kashmir or Himachal or Uttarakhand. But I have heard of reports in Ladakh, but I strongly believe that this snake is being in Ladakh as a result of moving along with wood stock, which comes, wood piles that are brought in by trucks. So there is a chance that the snake was brought into Ladakh because of that. But again, there could also be snakes that are found in Ladakh, Himalayan pit vipers, but I'm not sure. We have a lot of butterflies. There's records of 146 different species, of which I've seen about 45 species in Ladakh. But the most special of them is the Apollo, which you see in the middle.
It's actually a swallowtail butterfly. But what is interesting about the Apollo is it is actually the oldest living butterfly in the world. In fact, when I say oldest living, in its current form or current description, it has been the same even before the last ice ages. How did that butterfly survive an ice age? Because it's a cold-blooded animal, and especially in a place like Ladakh. The answer to that actually lies in the summer months. When you actually see these butterflies and the caterpillars actually go into the ground under the meadows. So they actually are found in high altitude meadows of Ladakh. So when the caterpillars, after they're feeding in the summer months, they actually overwinter underground. And then the butterflies emerge in the spring summer months. So that is how they're able to survive the colder conditions. And that's probably how they survived the last ice ages. And they've also exhibit a lot of geological isolation. Like for example, like I said, they're found only in high altitude meadows. So the population in the high altitude meadows of one mountain range and a population in the high altitude mountain of another mountain range could be or is two different species because they've been separate ever since the last ice ages, you can see. So if you go to any mountain pass in Ladakh, if it is in a different mountain range, you can look for a different species of Apollo. As of now, there are about 11 species of Apollos in the Himalayas and in Ladakh. So you can be sure that if you go to the Ladakh range, like Kardungla, you'll see a different species. If you go to Warila, you'll see a different species. If you go to Taglangla, you'll see a different species. If you go to Rotang, Rotang has its own species, Parnassus rotangensis. So that is also a different species. If you go to Zojila, you'll see a different species. So that's how special this particular butterfly is. And of course, every summer, apricot blossoms are great. Butterflies are great. But my fascination has always lay with these beautiful animals. They're the largest carnivores in Ladakh, the Himalayan brown bears. Like most bears, they hibernate in the winter months under the snow cover of western Ladakh. They're not found throughout Ladakh. They're found only the western limits along the Kargil, Zanskar, and Dras. So the Himalayan brown bears, if you go in the month of April, you can actually see them breaking out of the snow and coming out with their young ones, as because like as all the bears in the world, they give birth during hibernation and then they come out with their young ones. And it's quite fascinating to see, like you see in the picture in the frame here, that the cubs, when they come out, how excited they are to see their surroundings. And they are so playful while the mother is immediately rushing out in search of food because they haven't fed, she hasn't fed for 3 to 4 months of the winter. So it's quite amazing to see the brown bears. Again, an animal which is heavily persecuted because a lot of the food is found around army camps and villages. So they raid them very regularly. They eat a lot of flour, they eat a lot of veggies, they eat a lot of chicken and donkeys which are found in the village. So there's a lot of conflict, especially around a couple of villages in Dras. What happens is the brown bears hibernate very, very close to the village. In fact, about 50 meters from the village, I know about 3 or 4 brown bear dens, where you actually have bears hibernating in the winter months. And what happens is they're so close to the village that they can smell the food. This is my hypothesis. I could be wrong, but this is what I believe happens, that they actually come out in January and February in the peak winter months, do a short raid of the village and go back to hibernation. This is a very unique behavior of bears that hibernate world over. I believe it's because of the artificial availability of food and also because of the fact that the dens are located so close to the villages. So the largest bear I've seen, you can say is about, I would say it's about 250 kilograms. So they're quite massive, stocky animals. And there are a couple of places where you can be sure to see them. The best time to see them definitely would be the times when they're most active, which is just after hibernation or just when they're feeding in a frenzy before they go back into hibernation in the month of November. There's also another very interesting aspect of Ladakh, one that is not very easy to notice when you're first going there. But if you look at this map in the middle, you see the Jammu and Kashmir label. The region to the right of that is Ladakh. So basically, if you look at Ladakh, below Ladakh, that is to the south, is the Himalayas. To the left or to the east is the Eurasia. To the north is the Karakoram Mountains. And to the right or to the west is the Tibetan Plateau. So Ladakh is actually a very interesting junction where all these mountain ranges and geological formations meet. So it actually becomes a fantastic sample space for all the wildlife of Central Asia. For example, if you are in Ladakh, you can be sure that all the species found in Ladakh are found all the way till the Caspian Sea to the east, to Mongolia to the north, to the Sichuan Plateau to the west, and to the southern boundary or the spine of the Himalaya to the south. Excuse me. It's quite hard to understand this if you don't know the geology of the place. But what I'm trying to say is Ladakh has all the wildlife found in the Central Asian region, at least 90% of them. And this does not apply only to big mammals or birds. It applies to everything. For example, I'll show you a few examples. The ibex from the south, the markhor from the east, woolly hare in the Himalayas and Tibet, cape hare that comes from Persia, Himalayan marmot, which is found in the Himalayas and Tibet, long-tailed marmot, which is found all the way till Spain. Other examples could be the Tibetan snowcock to the east, the Himalayan snowcock to the south and the west, the red fox and the Tibetan sand fox. There is examples of the Eurasian lynx being found there, the Pallas's cat from Tibet, the lynx from Eurasia. There is other examples you can say even the amongst the ungulates, apart from the ibex and the markhor, which is another wild goat species that you some people say is found in the extreme western limit of Ladakh, but I'm not sure. The Baral is from the Himalayas. The Argali is from Tibet. The Uriel is native to Ladakh. So if you look at all these examples, you can say that if you go in for a 600,000 kilometers to the east of Ladakh, you're not going to find any other different species than what you find in Ladakh, including the Tibetan antelope, the Tibetan gazelle, Tibetan sand fox, birds like the Tibetan lark, white rump snowfinch, rufous neck snowfinch. All of them are found in Ladakh. So Ladakh, interestingly, is located in such a beautiful way that it has all the wildlife from all around in that one small area. It's not small, it's 90,000 square kilometer, but it has this interesting composition of mountains, and it's a very interesting junction that all this wildlife is found in. Like any habitat in the world, Ladakh has its problems. And Ladakh has even a bigger problem because of its location with the political boundaries and also how delicate the habitat actually is. Because you can see that there is a fine balance of seasons, fine balance of food availability, fine balance of predator-prey ratios. So when this is upset, a lot of things can go wrong. For example, I'll start with the image to the bottom right. Like I told you, I told you earlier that the Tibetan antelope, I'll come back to later in the talk. The Tibetan antelope is actually found in one particular valley in Ladakh, which is not accessible to common man like us because of the political issues over there with China. But what is interesting is the males are found in that valley, while the females migrate across the border to a lake in China or Tibet, whatever you want to call it, give birth over there, and then migrate back in the months of July and August to again join up with the males, and there's a courtship, and then the females go back. This is a very interesting cross-border migration, but unfortunately, because of the border issues that are happening there, a lot of the border is fenced, and this has affected the breeding behavior of these beautiful antelope. And apart from that, this antelope is also heavily persecuted in their range, both in Ladakh and in Tibet, because of shatush, which is a kind of wool, which is the finest form of wool in the world, which people make shawls with. And to make one shawl, I've heard that it requires four different chiru. And so they shoot a lot of these animals, and they're heavily persecuted for this illegal trade. It's been made illegal. Of course, because of development and the artificial availability of food and food wastage in the summer months, what has happened is there is a huge dog problem in Ladakh. And generally, people feel a lot of affection to dogs, including the army camps. So they put a lot of food out. So even in the remotest corners of Ladakh, you have feral dogs. What has happened because of feral dogs is, of course, number one, there's a lot of predation of wildlife like kiang and uriel. There is also a lot of predation on black-neck crane chicks. So the black-neck crane breeding the last 3-4 years has been heavily affected because of that. About 32 nests have been recorded in Ladakh. And the year I went around looking at these nests, only 4 of them survived. All the other nests had their chicks killed off by dogs. In fact, one pair tried to breed again and raised another chick, which was again killed off because the chicks can't fly for the first 3 months. So they're quite easy to for the dogs to pick out. Another problem is, of course, the wolf. The wolf and the dog, for some strange reason, are able to mate in Ladakh. And the result is this weird-looking animal that you see to the bottom left. The locals call it a kipshang. So because of the increase in the number of dogs and a drop in the number of wolves, what has happened is there's a lot of cross-breeding between these two animals, and a lot of the native pure gene pool of wolves is being lost to this cross that you see. And these animals actually behave more like wolves. They organize feral dogs into packs. They even form packs of both wolves and dogs, and they actually behave in a very dominant way. It is a big problem. I'm not sure when the government is going to take the initiative to take care of the dogs, maybe neuter them, maybe control the waste. A lot of things are happening, but it's not happening at a fast enough pace to save the wildlife, in my point of view. And of course, the problems with the snow leopard we already discussed earlier. They feed a lot on livestock, so there is a lot of retaliatory killing in places where the corrals have put up. Their things are fine, but unfortunately in remote villages which haven't got access to forest department or to funds, what happens is when the villagers lose their livestock to snow leopards, they generally poison them or pelt them with stones and kill them. Every year in some villages, you can hear that, oh, this village killed 3 leopards, or that village killed 2 leopards this year in the winter months. But there is a reason to this. Of course, the conflict is there, but these villages are so far interiorly located inside the mountains that for the farmer to come and find a forest department office in Leh and then take the guy back to his village to show the carcass, which the forest department person has to confirm is that of a snow leopard kill. And then they all go back to Leh to collect the compensation. It is not practical. Probably the farmer would have spent more money doing this than, you can say, then it's a lot easier for him to just take care of the leopard himself. That's what I'm trying to say. It's a very crude way of saying it, but unfortunately, that's the truth. So there is a lot of issues. So the Snow Leopard Conservancy and the department are slowly spreading their influence into other parts of Ladakh. There's a lot of education programs happening. A lot of new homestays are being brought about. But the snow leopard, yes, is going through a lot of progress. But unfortunately, like I told you earlier, the wolf is still in a very bad shape in Ladakh. There is actually no compensation program for wolves. So in a wolf den like this one, if the villagers spot it, you can be sure that they will go there and burn it down with the pups inside. So they don't want wolves because wolves take a lot of their livestock. And what the wolves do, unlike the snow leopard, is they finish off most of the carcass in a matter of hours. So the farmer cannot actually show evidence that a wolf has or wild animals has killed his carcass, because in most of the occasions he can't even find the remains of his dead livestock. So the villagers tend to take matters into their own hands. Sometimes the villagers are so happy to have snow leopards, but they don't want wolves. That is actually a big problem for wolves in Ladakh, apart from the feral dog issue. So like I told you, Snow Leopard Conservancy has set up a lot of homestays in the region to make sure the income from tourism and wilderness tourism comes straight into the houses. And this has changed the attitudes in a lot of villages towards wildlife, because villagers now see that if they have a lot of snow leopards and wolves and ibex around their villages, people will come and stay in their houses and they earn a lot of money. Of course, these cattle corrals were also set up, which changed attitudes towards snow leopards, because the snow leopards were usually killing livestock by coming into the village at night, jumping into the pens and killing off the animals either inside the pen or dragging them into the mountains. So these corrals also helped mitigating the conflict a lot. There is a lot more to be understood about snow leopards. Recent data suggested that only 12% of the international range has been studied. The estimate in Ladakh actually says 200 to 600 animals. That is how limited our information is on the cats, even within Ladakh. The number has been brought about by doing studies in a couple of areas and then extrapolating the number. In my experience, in a 50 square kilometer area, I've seen about 12 different cats in the area where I work. But again, if I cannot comment on the exact number of cats in Ladakh. A lot of studies by camera traps, by the spotters, by the conservancy and the department is making progress. But unfortunately, the snow leopard is an animal that doesn't recognize borders. So a snow leopard in the northern part of Ladakh could be in Pakistan the next day. It could move into Tibet, could move into other states, into Jammu and Kashmir, into Dehradun, not what am I saying, Dehradun, sorry, into Great Himalayan National Park, Pin Valley, into Gangotri National Park. So snow leopards are known to cover over 150 to 200 kilometers, sometimes in search of territory and prey. So there is a lot of complications in studying and conserving these cats, unlike the comforts of a jeep or a positive ID or habitat control or the extent of information that we have with regards to tigers. But a significant change was brought about in 2013 in Kyrgyzstan, where all the Central Asian countries met and they actually declared the snow leopard the ambassador of the mountains. So what happened because of this was they said that they will allow cross-border conservation. So a lot of new countries like Afghanistan, Kyrgyzstan, Kazakhstan actually have now become fantastic places for snow leopards because a lot of studies are happening there. A lot of locals have been educated on snow leopards, and snow leopard free movement of snow leopards is now observed across all these different countries. And there are actually scientists who are working pan the landscape, pan the limits of the borders to study snow leopards. So it's a significant change. And it can go a long way in understanding these cats, but we are still, you can say, at the ABC of snow leopards. It will take a long time before we get to the alphabet Z. I'd like to finish off this session with this image, which for me is a very unique frame because it tells the story of the snow leopard. Not much is known about the leopard unless it visits the human. I mean, you can be sure that this leopard is seen most often only when the leopard chooses to show itself next to one of the villages, like this one here, which chose to walk through an old monastery. And it is one of the most precious moments of my life to see this snow leopard like this. And the image tells a lot of stories for me because it tells a story of cats that are living in people's backyards, but we still don't know enough about them to conserve them successfully. So that's that. I hope all of you enjoyed the session. I tried to cover as much as possible on Ladakh. It is an alien landscape. And even for me, after spending 4 years, I have a lot of different topics to still understand in Ladakh. I've tried to do my best and try to simplify information as much as possible. But for those who have questions, please post it one question a person, and don't keep sharing continuously because then I lose the questions. If you see another person sending a question, I would request all of you to wait for that person's question to be answered before the next question comes across. Thank you. I'm super curious to know where you've seen amphibians in Ladakh. You want to catch them on your next visit. Yeah, I have seen amphibians in Zanskar Valley, in the Suru Valley and Zanskar Valley, where the Suru River forms a couple of oxbow lakes. And there is also a couple of freshwater springs inside the side valleys, especially in a village called Panikkar, where I've seen Nanorana genus and I've seen the Bufo Lastatsi or the Ladakh toad. So I hope that answers your question. But I would say when you catch frogs, please be careful. There's a lot of, there's a particular virus called Chytrid, which is spreading to the amphibians. You don't want to be the reason for frogs in remote valleys catching the virus. So please be careful when you handle frogs. Make sure your hands are clean or wear gloves. How well, as per you, is the herpetofauna studied? There is actually a couple of studies in Pakistan and in Tibet. But in Ladakh, I know Karthik Vasudevan did a preliminary studies. But I don't have access to his paper, so I'm not really sure. Any solution for the feral dog problem in Ladakh? Of course, there is solution, definitely. But it is a solution that can be implemented only by government, because it's a sector which only the government can take a call on. And it has to be implemented in such a large scale that I would say, like, there are almost 5,000 dogs or 6,000 dogs in Ladakh. It's a very rough guess, but it could be a whole lot higher. So controlling the waste and starting to neuter these dogs would be a place where a person can start. But it requires a lot of will by the government to do this. Where would you recommend one stays to be able to see some Ladakh in Ladakh on a visit? Well, depends on when you come. Depends on what you want to see. So if you want to see snow leopards, you go stay in the mountains in the winters. Ule is a nice place. Rumbak is a nice place. Stoknala is a nice place. But if you want to see birds, I would suggest coming in the summer months and going to the different habitats. Nubra and Sokar are very good places to see birds. Excuse me. Nubra and Sokar, which is a high altitude lake, are a good place to see birds in the summer months. Snow leopards in India are not GPS tagged. I have a question there. One second. Please stop the questions. One second. This is by Vedang Sai Kekar. It's a very interesting problem. They're not GPS tagged because the army doesn't give you permissions to GPS tag cats because it interferes with their satellite data that they receive. So it's quite interesting that snow leopards have a unique problem about collaring. Okay, I've got a question here. Is the lynx being poached? Read somewhere. Of course it is. Again, lynx, like I told you, though it's considered to be a small cat, it's actually a very big stocky cat. It can weigh up to 26, 27 kilograms. And I've actually heard of lynx bringing down a young burrell. So it's a cat which can definitely go after livestock. So in certain parts of Ladakh, especially where the nomadic herders move in the Changtang Plateau, the lynx is often seen as a carnivore to their pashmina goats and sheep. So there is a lot of poisoning. And in fact, there's a very interesting story that was told to me by a friend, Payal, which he heard from another herder, where he said that if you see a lynx, it's a very easy animal to kill because you chase it for a while and it takes huge jumps and then suddenly stops because it can't run further and just crouches like that, and then they just kill it by pelting it with stones. It sounds horrible, but that is what the herders do when they see a lynx. What gives away the difference between a wolf dog and a wolf? Basically, you need to keep looking at wolves. You need to know exactly what a wolf is. And then when you know exactly how a wolf looks, you can be sure that when you see a wolf dog, it's something is wrong about it. The tail, the face proportion. It looks more like an Alsatian or a German Shepherd, the wolf dog. Very close to Lake Ganges. I have seen wolves in Ganges, so there is a chance, but very rare. Anupranay. Thank you. Any conservation projects? No, unfortunately not. There's no conservation projects for wolves in Ladakh yet. There is some initiatives by the Snow Leopard Conservancy to educate people, but because it's such a complicated problem, like there's no compensation, it is very hard to find evidence of a carcass that has been killed by a wolf. There is a feral dog problem, of course. So it's a very complicated animal. It's not an animal that is restricted to one habitat. It can move through large areas overnight sometimes. So it is quite a complicated issue. Well, I have a question from Aindrila Sarkar. Is the food chain simple in Ladakh or complex? I don't think there's ever a simple food chain in anywhere in the world. And like that, in Ladakh also, there's a very complicated food chain. Which is the most complex? I don't really have an answer to that. But you can definitely say something that involves the lammergeier, the vultures, the snow leopard, the wolf, the fox, the vole, the weasel, the pika, and of course the flora, which the pikas feed on. That would form an interesting chain. Which areas are the best to see lynx? If you find out the answer, let me know. I have seen lynx a lot in Nubra. But the best area, as far as I've seen with a lot of sightings in the winter months, is a village called Yurutse in the national park, Hemis National Park. I'll take... Varun, you asked that question. Varun Mathur, okay. Next time you want to see a lynx, just tell me. We'll go together. What about vegetation in Ladakh? There were always no images or mentions of trees or plants. Thank you, Gibran. That was an interesting question. Trees are really not that much in Ladakh. Most of the trees that you see in the villages and in the cities only because they've been planted. They are willows and poplars, which have been planted for the timber requirement of the people and the construction purposes. But if you move away from the villages, you don't really see much trees. Towards Western Ladakh and in some parts of Central Ladakh, you can see some juniper trees, which is the only native tree. There's also walnut trees in some villages, but I'm not sure whether they're native or they've been planted. Because you have to remember that there was a lot of trade in Ladakh through the centuries. So people from Kashmir were traveling through to Tibet because it is all part of the Silk Route. So what happens is there was a lot of apricot brought in. There was a lot of walnut brought in. There's a lot of apples being brought in. So there was a lot of trees which are planted. There was not much native. So the juniper is the only native tree. And with regards to flora, there is a lot of flora in Ladakh. You can be sure that the meadows have their own species. The plateaus have their own species. There's a lot of wild roses. There's a lot of different bushes. There is lavenders. There is nepeta. There's a whole lot of different species, but it is a different topic altogether to cover. And I will need a separate session for that. Is there any other question which I've left out? Otherwise, we can end this. I'm going to lose my voice soon. Which part of Ladakh is greener? As you go west, things get greener. Yes, towards Kargil, Dras. As you go south, in Zanskar, things get greener. But there is no greener area. Like even in central Ladakh, if you go to some valleys, it is greener. If you go to the meadows, it's greener. And generally, all the greener places have a little bit more bird activity. But you cannot say that's a sure thing. Is the species wolf dog cross scientifically different in name? It doesn't have a scientific name because it is a hybrid species and it's not accepted as a species yet. What books do you recommend for flora? Well, I am trying to come out with a book. So that would be a good reference or a starting point. But having said that, there is a one particular Czech book called Flowers of Ladakh. It is not easily available, but I think it's there in NHBS. And of course, the old publication, which is the Wildflowers of the Himalaya, can be a reference also. If I see an eagle owl in Ladakh region, should I be sure being Eurasian eagle owl? Yes, there is a significant difference between Eurasian and Indian, and definitely in Ladakh, you see only Eurasian. Indian eagle owl has a very clear disc of black around the face. Well, and the Eurasian eagle owl doesn't have it. And of course, Eurasian eagle owl is almost 30% bigger, you can see. Stanton and Pulonin, and that's the wildflowers of the Himalayas. But unfortunately, that covers a lot more of the Himalaya for flowers and doesn't do a specific session on flora of only Ladakh. Okay, guys, I think let's wrap up over there. Thank you so much for joining in. It has been good fun. I'm sorry about the people who missed it the other day. I'm glad all of you could make it today. I hope it was useful. And for those of you who have any more further questions, I'm just leaving my number over there. Otherwise, you can always contact me in Facebook and Instagram. And those of you who know where I live can, of course, come home. I'm not going to tell you guys where I live. If you ever decide to come to Ladakh, keep me in the loop. I'll be happy to help. Be safe and hopefully all of you will be out in the wilderness once this lockdown ends. Thank you so much. Thank you. I'm going to stop the session. Cheers.